Before I begin the review of the newest episode of One Piece, I just want to go over the new trailer that we got for Film Gold. Link is in the description. So the trailer introduces us to Gil Tesoro, who is obviously in charge of a casino, an entertainment ship the size of an island. We see some of his henchmen, as well as the Straw Hat crew entering this place. Now the reason why I think we see Akainu in this trailer is because I think I read somewhere that the ship, this particular ship, is the only place that has permission from the world government to allow gambling or something like that. So they're authorized. They have legal authorization to, you know, just have all these games and, you know, gambling and stuff. I seriously doubt that Akainu will serve a major role in the plot just because he's so important to the main storyline. And for the most part, like, these movies, even though they are supervised by Oda, they're usually kind of side quests. Honestly, so far from what I've seen, the best part of the movie, as of right now to me, are the Straw Hat's outfits. They just look so badass. We have this shot here. Is it just me, or does Luffy's arm seem more buff than usual? It's a good thing, though. Then we have Zoro there. At first, I thought he was wearing his bandana, his typical black bandana that he uses when he's about to KO his opponents. But no, it's actually, it looks like he's wearing a cap. And Sanji, he's actually doing an axe kick. And I think at this point they're trying to escape a security system, which means that the Straw Hats are probably going to find themselves trapped within Tesoro's ship, within his domain. We see Nami, Usopp, and Chopper there being gradually turned to gold, which automatically, like, gives away Tesoro's ability, which is, you know, I think he's probably a Paramecia, just because, an awakened Paramecia at that, because if you see those vines, like those golden vines that look like a tree or like some type of, like, a root that's coming out from the ground, it kind of looks like Doflamingo's way of manipulating strings. So I'm pretty sure he's an awakened devil fruit user for sure. I don't know why it's always like Nami, Usopp, and Chopper that get caught up in the bullshit. I also have no idea who that fourth person is that we see in the background right after Chopper. But anyway, we see this shot of Luffy here. If you pause it, you can notice that his arms have already been turned to gold. I don't know if this is a reference to Skypiea, but I just really hope that Luffy doesn't remain incapacitated in the movie for very long, because that's going to suck. It just feels like it would be like a very convenient way of stopping Luffy from fighting. And I want Luffy to go gear fourth on this bitch. Like, I want him to blast this entire ship to hell. If Gil Tesoro is that much of a douchebag, I just want him to destroy the entire ship. Random shot of Heracles there. I'm not really sure what Usopp's trainer is supposed to be doing in a casino, but whatever. So let me know what your thoughts are, judging from the content that we've seen. I'm pretty sure most of you have already seen the group designs, like the character designs, the outfits. I mean, for me, the visuals and the environment just look amazing, stunning. I'm just not sold on the story just yet, but it's still very early, so we'll see.
One Piece, episode 733. I feel like, okay, this episode is one of the few exceptions in which, like, despite some problems with it here and there, animation-wise and pacing-wise, I just let the episode take me for a ride. I honestly enjoyed this episode a lot. It was just, a lot of it had to do with the music, like the build-up with the music, but also the action. They know, like, it's either go big or go home, because they have no stamina left, right from Jump Street, right from the start. Doffy was done fucking around. Just straight up stab Luffy. Try to kill this kid. I had enough. Haki up with the strings. Awakening mode. Try and stab his abdomen. You know, I kind of don't understand why he just focused all of his strings on Luffy's abdomen. It would have been better to have the strings hit different points of Luffy's body. Because I don't think that Luffy can go... I mean, can he go full armament? Well, I don't know. But basically, he slams Luffy into a wall. By the way, he has like a really, Doffy has a really nice attack that makes him look like an actual flamingo, because the spikes from the strings turn into feathers around him. But anyways, he sends Luffy out into the mountain, then he uses Parasite to control him, and because I realized that he was having a hard time manipulating Luffy with the strings, I guess it's Luffy's will that it was just really strong. So he breaks out of the strings, starts blowing into his arm, and I do have to say that I'm kind of conflicted in terms of how I feel about this, because it's obvious that they reused the exact, it was just copy and paste, the same animation for the Gear 4th transformation that they did when Luffy went Gear 4th for the first time. And the reason why I'm conflicted is, okay, they either did that or they decided to, you know, animate the transformation again and possibly, like, fuck it up, like, give us something, like, really shitty. So I'm kind of okay, but at the same time, it's kind of like, you just copy and pasted that shit. The animators were just like, fuck it. No shame. Activate gear paste. The gear paste is deadly. You don't want to overuse it. And how can I leave out that Rayleigh flashback? It was just really endearing. Like, I just like hearing his voice because he has the voice of like an old mentor who's like really friendly, but really like serious at the same time. It's a combination of both. And he's just laughing it up with Luffy. He's like, you need to figure something out with your hockey. And Luffy's solution is just, okay, once I get to the gear fourth stage, I'm just going to blow on my arm. See how that works. So Luffy's solution to everything is just blow. That's the message. No, but you know shit's about to get heavy. I heard that Rob Lucci music, the Jet Gatling. Yeah, it's just like, it got me hyped as hell. The choice of tracks in this episode were absolutely on point, and I think the episode benefited greatly from that. There's a back and forth, very briefly, very ideologically heavy, specifically coming from Doflamingo, in terms of his justification of why he has like a God-given right to oppress people, which we know, ooh, fucking crazy. Yeah, so everybody's below him. He says, like, you know, if you were born inferior to me, then that's there's nothing much I can do about that. You just suck. Like, blame your circumstances. Blame the people that gave birth to you. I'm just better than you because I used to be a celestial dragon. He's justifying the oppression, and Luffy, who stands for freedom, you know, being autonomous, being independent, he just can't stand that shit. And I love Luffy's line, like, all this bullshit, it makes me feel like I'm suffocating. Which makes perfect sense, and it goes along with the image of the birdcage. So once you see that massive inflated arm, you're like, oh shit. And I think they handled it really smartly, because once that hit lands, they kill the sound, and you get a long shot of the ocean, and you see the waves, like the impact waves on the sea, just blowing to shh, and the hockey clash is all over. Like, it's blowing everything. Like, it creates a massive wind wave. There's dust and rocks and shit. People are like, oh, fuck. Like, it was nuts. And you see, like, the thunder of the clash. It was great. Like, I thought it was really handled well. And Doflamingo's not giving up either. So his strings are just trying to pierce Luffy's, his knuckles. And so what that does is that it creates a back and forth between the strings and the punch. And I don't recall, please remind me, was that in the manga, that mini back and forth? Because they even had enough time to have, like, the headshots of some of the most important characters of the arc and have them say, Luffy, Lucci, Mugiwara! But in the manga, I felt like the gun landed a lot faster, like a lot cleaner for some reason. And don't get me wrong, the facial expressions for both Luffy and Doflamingo in this were on point. That was great. Like, that, to me, that was the highlight of the episode, both Luffy and Doflamingo's expressions. And so it lands, it creates a fucking giant hole. And again, for whatever reason, because Oda gave us a long shot of Dressrosa, I just automatically assumed that he get pretty much split the island in half, like made the island go like, but in the anime, they just handled it like, oh, it's just like a portion of the country of Dressrosa that's being kind of like torn to fucking shit by the punch. And obviously that last little montage there with Corazon, with Law looking up, and he's finally, you know, he can finally get that sense of closure for Corazon that he didn't have and that he hasn't had up until this point in the story. So it was nice. It was really a nice closing. You know what they say, don't you? It ain't over until the flamingo's glasses crack. And they cracked. It took them a while, and we still don't get to see his eyes. I remember when this chapter came out, a lot of people were already comparing the arc Dressrosa to the arc of Alabasta, because both of them follow similar formats. But I remember specifically from this chapter, people were doing the comparison, oh, it's interesting, it's a nice contrast of how, like, when Luffy defeated Crocodile, he sends him to the sky, he sends him upward, and when Luffy defeats Doflamingo, he sends him downward into a pit. So it's like both of them are tyrants, both of them were trying to take over a kingdom, and this is how they end. There's a very nice moment in this episode, very brief moment, with Leo and Robin, when Leo tells Robin, like, Robilando, whatever her fucking nickname is, according to the Sontara, but he complains, and then Robin just shuts him up. She's like, believe in Luffy. And I love that it's her who says that quote, because I think it's Usopp who tells her the exact same thing in the train on the way to Enies Lobby. And that's a period, a very dark time in Robin's life, where she was like really doubtful about whether or not her friends were going to end up betraying her or whatever. So the fact that she is the one spreading out the trust, you know, talking about how much she trusts Luffy, how much faith she has in her captain. I thought that was great. Overall, I enjoyed the episode. It could have been better. Certain parts could have been handled better, but I just went with it, man. I just enjoyed it. I went with it, and yeah, this is the review you get. Thank you so much for watching. Like the video if you did. Share your thoughts down below, and subscribe for more One Piece material. Thank you, guys. Catch you later.